I have a scouting system whose sole object is to go out looking for young promising school boys, youth club boys, and indeed any young players who have the necessary natural ability to have a, make a future Manchester United player.
I have been a very fortunate man. I spent my life in the game that I love. As a player, I had the privilege of playing among the finest in my day. As a manager, I have the honour of serving what I believe to be the best club in the world.
Sir Matt Busby speaking in 1967, when he was awarded the freedom of the city of Manchester. He was looking back over a career that had taken him from the pits of Bells Hill to the pinnacle of European club football.
I was born in a pitman's cottage. And the doctor who delivered me said, a footballer has come to this house this day. He may have said that about most of the boys with whom he delivered. But in my case, it very nearly was proved wrong.
He was born a leader right from the off. My dad. I'll tell you, like, when he got 9 years of age, his father got killed in the First World War.
He got killed at the Battle of the Somme, I think it was. And of course, my dad took the responsibility of the whole family from being about 14, I think, 12 or 14.
He told me about his remembered losing his father in the First World War, and how he got a telegram, and the Pals regiments and all the boys in the village, Bells Hill, all joined, a lot of them all joined up together, and of course they were all killed together in May 1917.
He went down the mines, Coalface, to fetch a wage in. From the family point of view, his mother and his three younger sisters. And I think he learnt a lot down the mines. You know, it was rough and you had to look after yourself, even at 14 and 15 years of age.
One of the genuine miracles of world football, not simply British football, is that three of the greatest managers who ever contributed to the game, Sir Matt Busby, Bill Shankly and Jock Stein, all came from what used to be the Southwest Scotland coalfield, were all born within 20 miles of one another. They learned something about human relations, about communal activity. They learned about teamwork in the most fundamental way imaginable, where it was a matter of life and death.
As a distraction to his harsh life as a collier, Busby turned his attention to the football pitch.
By this time, my dad had got the football bug really strong. He was a very good young player because he was at St. Bride's down Bothwell, an area just outside Bells Hill, and they won everything. You know, they had a good side and they won everything.
Busby's fledgling football career nearly ended before it had begun. His family's plans would have taken him far away from the English game.
My mother decided that as soon as I was able to stand on my own feet, I should emigrate to America. But chance, luck, destiny, call it what you will, has played a great part in my life and played a great part in this occasion. My application for a visa at that time was delayed. And that delay changed the whole course of my life. Instead of emigrating to America, I emigrated to Manchester.
But it was the blue half of Manchester that first took Busby on at the age of 17.
They thought a lot of him, but he was slow as an inside forward. He was slow.
For after 2 years, I was playing so badly that I was almost in despair. Dr. Johnson said one time that much may be made of a Scotsman if he is caught young. I had decided that if much was to be made of me, it would appear I would have to try some other career other than football. Then suddenly, in an emergency, I was called upon to play right half-back in a Northern Midweek League game, and in that position, and from that moment, success came to me.
The change of position was a success, both for Busby and Man City, with the team appearing in the FA Cup semi-final in 1932, the final in 1933, before beating Portsmouth to lift the trophy in 1934.
The winning goal. Look at that Portsmouth player taking the ball out of the net. Hasn't his back got a sweet expression?
By this time, Busby had already earned his one and only Scotland cap in the autumn of 1933.
He got a bad injury. When I say a bad injury, a pulled thigh muscle, because he was quite well built, my dad. And they couldn't get it right in them days. They used to just get on the table and keep on rubbing it, which was the worst thing you could do. In them days, the directors told the manager, you put this player in, you play that player, etc., you know. And they sold him to Liverpool for quite a big sum in them days, £8,000.
With Liverpool, Busby was to make regular first-team appearances and became team captain. But the onset of the war in 1939 put an end to his Liverpool playing career. He enlisted and joined the army as a PT instructor.
While he was in the army, he became in charge of the combined forces, which included Frank Swift, Stan Matthews, Tommy Lawton, great players, Joe Mercer, Stan Cullis, and the army. So, once again, the leader, they put my dad in charge.
Busby's side toured Italy in 1945. The end of the war was to see Busby's return to Liverpool as assistant manager.
He had gone from Manchester City to Liverpool. And then a very remarkable man who you never hear very much about these days, Louis Rocker, who was the chief scout and a friend of Matt's. He'd been with United since the Newton locomotive days. He went to Liverpool and on behalf of the club and persuaded Matt to come.
Louis Rocker thought the world of my dad. Even when he was at City, he thought, this is something special. And he started writing to my dad while he was in the forces, offering him the Man United job. But my dad was still on the Liverpool books. And you can read between the lines, Louis Rocker's more or less saying, you know, I don't want to get involved with this, Matt, but we would like you to think about it for the future. We'd love you to come as our manager.
The correspondence was kept deliberately vague in case it fell into the wrong hands at Liverpool. Louis Rocker referred only to a job. Busby accepted the offer on his own terms, but war had left the club and its stadium almost in ruins.
Well, the stadium at that point was really derelict, and the great stands, the Archibald Leach stands, were broken. The Stretford end, there was part of the stand, the main stand, still standing. But all of the whatever had been offices and what have you had gone. But there was a tree growing in the stand, and I made a portrait of that tree because it fascinated me. And the irony of it is that when they rebuilt the stadium, Matt used to sit in a seat in the director's box almost exactly where that tree grew.
Busby took over in the October of 1945 and almost immediately offered the job of assistant manager to Welshman Jimmy Murphy. Then he turned his attention to the players.
The set of lads he had coming back from the war definitely had ability. But they were all out of place, you know, like Johnny Kelly, the great Johnny Kelly, was an inside forward. My dad put him back to right back. Played for the rest of Europe against England. Johnny Ashton was a centre forward. He put him back to left back, played for England. Little Henry Colburn was an inside forward, he put him back to wing half, played for England. Alan Chilton was an inside forward, put him back to centre half, played for England. Jack Rowley, he was an inside forward, he put him as a total centre forward, called him the Gunner because of his fantastic shooting ability.
The changes had an instant impact, with United ending the 46-47 season as runners-up. The following season would see them defeat Blackpool in the final of the FA Cup.
Having a bomb site of a ground, we played at Main Road for 5 years, rented it. And I was at Main Road when they played Yeovil Town, who were a non-league team at the time, and there was 81 to 82,000 people on that ground watching Man United play a non-league side.
Well, I think he realised in the sense that at the team talks he was fantastic at analysing the opposition. You almost knew what the opposition had had for breakfast before you went out. And he was excellent at that. You realise too that probably at that time, of course, it wasn't until after the final that he became more of a power. He was still, like us, somebody employed by the club. But then he became a manager of note, and he was sort of, he could dominate the club to some degree.
But the war years had taken its toll on the side, and Busby realised if he was to enjoy continued success, he would have to rejuvenate his Manchester United team.
Matt nurtured the club and nurtured the idea of football with young players.
My first idea was to try and build on young boys, young players, and bring them up in the club atmosphere, and feeling for the club, and character-wise, loyalty-wise.
Matt Busby's vision created a team that would never reach its true potential, a team who will always be remembered as the Busby Babes.
He took the team to Europe, but no one, I mean, in fact, Alan Hardick of the Football League, he tried to stop him. He tried to stop United into European football in 1956. Chelsea had won the league, United went to Europe. You know, they should have been going into Europe, Chelsea, but United weren't there. They got to two semi-finals right away, you know, with all these great young...
Vision of introducing players as young as 16 into his side was quickly put into practice. He recruited a team of assistants to help him gather his new squad together.
It was quite revolutionary what he did, developing a programme of youth development, recruiting and scouting players from all over the British Isles and the Republic of Ireland, trying to get the best schoolboy players into the football club, and then nurturing them, training them, coaching them, with the ultimate aim of getting them into the first team as soon as possible.
That was his idea. He thought, if I become manager, I'm going to get a young side together. I'll get scouts and I'll get a staff, and that's what I'm going to build. And he got a great scout in Joe Armstrong, a little fella, great character.
He established a lot of contacts and just related to people who ran particularly schoolboy teams, district school teams.
Joe was given the job to tour around more or less England to find out schoolboys the best you can get and fetch them to Manchester United Football Club.
Gradually, Busby introduced his youngsters into the team, Albert Scanlon and David Pegg joining players such as Jackie Blanchflower. One notable addition was to be Duncan Edwards, one of the finest players of his time, who was to earn his first England cap at the age of 18. This team of young players soon drew attention to themselves, earning the nickname the Busby Babes.
I'd been aware of Manchester United because of the Busby Babes, the young players that suddenly burst onto the first division, which was a tough division. And so I was really wanting to come to Man United when I left school anyway.
The club I joined had that wonderful freshness of youth, and he had that about him.
It was the feeling of awe that everybody had when they spoke about Matt Busby. Like he was such a god, you know, at Manchester United with what he'd done.
Busby also instilled into these players a philosophy, a style of playing that United adopted and have practiced ever since.
He says, "You know, Bobby, son," and his gruff Scots accent, you know. He said, "You see all these people," and in those days, everybody working in Trafford Park used to go past here. You know, hundreds and hundreds of people every morning. He says, you know, all those people, they're going to work. He says, and they might work on conveyor belts or whatever, but, you know, it might be dirty work, etc. He says, but they do expect on a Saturday when they go to the football that they'll see something different.
He always encouraged attacking football and flowing football. He gave us jobs of stopping the star players and things like that on the opposition, but it was attacking football was in his mind.
Playing with this style of attacking football, Busby's Babes won the league championship in 1956 and 1957, and also made it to that year's FA Cup final, ending up as runners-up to Aston Villa. But Busby had set his eyes on another trophy.
He had his eyes on Europe from about 1956. When he saw the standard of football at teams that he played, he wanted to be in there. He wanted to be up there all the time.
To put his team up against the great Europe side team, because they wanted to see the great players of Europe, as well as, you know, his own great players, but he wanted to see what stage they had reached, Manchester United had reached.
He had this vision of things in the game broadening and improving, and, you know, if you're playing down a back alley on your own, you're not going to improve. You know, you have to spread out and go where the other great teams are. And this is what he wanted to do.
He'd been doing some coaching, apparently, in the United States. And he'd been to San Francisco, to Candlestick Park. And when he came back, he was telling everybody, he was so excited. He says, I've been to a stadium. He says, you would not believe. People are sitting behind glass, eating their meal while they're watching the game. And he says, we have to have it. He says, we have to have this. You know, this is. And we were talking at a time, just about the time, when Alan Hardacre and the Football League were trying to stop him from going into Europe. But his team were winning the championships. And if you won the championship, you could go and play. You were representing England in the European Cup.
Busby took on Alan Hardacre and the Football League and won. Manchester United were to be the first English side to play in the European Cup.
We're so excited because you then started to see television for the first time, and there was pictures coming of Real Madrid, Di Stefano and Puskas and all these players, Hento.
When he spoke about Alfred Di Stefano at Real Madrid, because they'd drawn him in the semi-final, he'd been to watch him, and he come back. And that was it. He'd seen this player. He'd never seen a player like him.
He went to see Reims play Real Madrid in the European Cup, as it was then. And when he came back, he was very reluctant to talk to anybody. Somebody, it might have been myself, said, what do you think, boss? You know, you saw Reims and Real Madrid play, you know. I believe they got some good play. What do you think? And he says, just you listen to what I'm telling you and don't talk about them. Because he was so impressed by them, you know. He'd seen Di Stefano and Hento and all these marvellous players. And I think he didn't want to worry us that they were so good. We were drawn to play Real Madrid and we lost 3-1. And we drew here 2-2 in the second leg, which, although we didn't win, gave us the idea that nobody was invincible, you know, and we had every right to be playing in Europe, and why not? And we were on the road, and he was the one that wanted to be on the road.
But that road into Europe came to an end on a Munich runway in the February of 1958. The plane carrying the team home from the tie against Red Star Belgrade crashed on takeoff. Initially, 7 players were killed along with 3 club officials. Eventually, the death toll climbed to 23. Duncan Edwards survived the crash, but died from his injuries 2 weeks later. Busby himself received multiple injuries, and the Munich doctors doubted if he would survive. Twice, he received the last rites.
Not a great religious man, but I was saying a prayer then, and all of a sudden an uncle shouted up, Sandy, he's alive, he's alive. Your dad's alive.
Despite the severity of his injuries, Busby started on the long road to recovery, and his family began to turn their attentions to those who had been less fortunate.
My mother sent me home on the sixth day, I think it was, to go to the funerals. She said, you've got to go and represent the family. Went, Mark Jones it's heartbreaking to see these young wives and girlfriends. Heartbreaking it was.
He felt it was his fault. He thought that it was, he was so seriously ill that we wondered whether he'd ever come back again, really.
I remember my first reaction was never to have anything to do with football again. And this was in my mind. And my wife went again. Come along one of these days and said, if these boys had to say that it's passed on, they would want you to carry on.
He was such a big man. He was a big man, you know, and he'd been cut down. And everybody wondered whether they would be able to survive, whether the club would ever be the same again.
United, with Jimmy Murphy in charge, had patched up a team. And that's all you could say, it was a patched team. You know, they played the likes of West Brom, who were a good side, a very good side at the time, at Old Trafford. And then they played Sheffield Wednesday at Old Trafford. And I'm sure them lads that played for them two clubs didn't know what hit them.
A blank team sheet in the Sheffield Wednesday matchday programme is an indication of Jimmy Murphy's struggle to keep a side together. In Munich, Busby was staging a remarkable recovery and was well enough to send a message to the Old Trafford crowd.
I can remember being in the ground here when the message came from Sir Matt, who was lying in his bed in the Munich hospital, to the crowd, and the silence, and if ever you could, the expression, you can touch silence, meant anything, it meant something on that particular day.
You will be glad, I'm sure, to know that the remaining players here and myself are now considered out of danger. And this can be attributed to the wonderful treatment and attention given us by Professor Maurer and his wonderful staff who are with you today as guests of the club. Again, it's wonderful to hear that the club have reached the semi-final of the FA Cup. And I enclose my best wishes to everyone.
When we heard what he had to say, the whole stadium burst into tears, really. It was great, but yet it hurt, you know.
When my dad was talking, it was a bit quiet and sullen, but the atmosphere when the lads kicked off was unbelievable.
Now fit enough to return to the UK, Busby was at first reluctant to step inside Old Trafford.
He had to get back because it was his team. They were his players. He'd been responsible for them.
When he came back, it just lifted everybody at the club.
He finally returned to the ground for a match against Newcastle.
He looked a bit frail. He had a stick and crutches and things. That didn't matter to us. We were just glad to see the man back. It was great to get him back.
He was determined, very determined. I always remember when he used to come into the ground after he'd come home and started moving about on his sticks. He would come to the bottom door and go and let him in at the director's door, and he would fight his way up the stairs on his sticks. Then he would give the sticks to me and he'd walk his way down the passage using the wall, making himself walk down to his office. And amazing spirit of the man.
Jimmy Murphy's team of reserves and emergency signings managed to make it through to that year's FA Cup final against Bolton Wanderers.
Somehow or other we managed to get to the cup final and we played against Bolton Wanderers, and he came back for it, and he was really quite ill. But nevertheless, he had to go. It was his club. These were his new players, a lot of new players. And we lost, but it didn't matter, because Matt Busby was back and we had survived. And a lot of people who thought the club might go out of existence, really. They might collapse completely with it. And they realised, you know, that nothing had changed.
He came to the cup final, but he didn't come back for months. It was so quiet at the ground. Of course, all the players, you know, the best players, and they were all young players, you know, that was killed. So it won a very happy club.
Back in charge at Old Trafford and reunited with his coaching staff, Busby could return his attentions to his damaged side.
He needed to build another team. He felt his work had...
Loss of so many of Busby's players at Munich had left the Manchester United squad devastated. With many of his first team now gone, Busby had a dilemma. How could he now set about rebuilding another great side?
He'd done a fantastic job before the crash. The team was a great side and probably might have reached the standards the present day has reached, but, you know, it was all shattered and he had to start again. Not very easy.
His philosophy had always been, you know, young players brought from school, brought through the system to become eventually first-team players. But there wasn't enough of them. It was an emergency. So different players were signed.
He knew there was one man that would inspire within that team, an authority of experience, a dynamic player, and also somebody who could cohesively, by example, pull people with him, like Duncan Edwards did with Dennis Law.
Getting Dennis Law was a key decision because he was he sparked it off. And Paddy Creran in midfield.
I remember the first time I ever met Matt, in actual fact, was we played a game against the Italian League at Hampden Park, and Dennis Law, strangely enough, was playing for the Italian League. And we should have beat the Italian League that night. But I met Matt in the lobby of the hotel because I was in the phone, was talking to a girl who's now my wife, and I said, do you know who's standing out in the lobby? Matt Busby. That's how important he was, even going back all those years. And I never met him again after that until I signed for United. Coming down here and getting into his office at Old Trafford and discussing money and all. Well, I didn't discuss money. He just opened his mouth and I just sat there in total awe of the man.
I mean, Sir Matt Busby had that 58 side. And, of course, he also had the 48 side. So he had built two great teams before. And now it was the sort of the beginning of trying to build another team.
The rebuilding of the side saw many established players brought to Old Trafford. In addition to Lorne Crerand, Albert Quixel, Maurice Setters and Noel Cantwell came to United.
When I came back from Italy, we nearly got relegated. I think we landed third bottom or whatever. I think we escaped with something like the last couple of games of the season. But fortunately, in that particular time, we got to the cup final.
It's Leicester City who have won through to the final by sheer teamwork against Manchester United, that galaxy of stars who have often disappointed, but who today believes their renowned manager, Matt Busby, on the right, will dazzle the football world.
The addition of these experienced players started to bring success back to the club, and the rejuvenated side went on to beat Leicester City in the 1963 FA Cup final.
To go there and actually go to Wembley and win. And that was really the start of a team that for 5-6 years, you know, became something. Because then we went on to win the league a couple of years later, and then we won the league, and then, of course, the lads went on to win the European Cup. So it was a very nice time.
Despite having to look to bought in talent to supplement his team, Busby had not forgotten his desire to nurture younger players.
We were fortunate then, that particular next season, as a young boy came up into the side who would then turn out to be one of the greatest players that the game has seen in George Best.
Matt went on to create a forward line with three world-class players in it, which was unique in the world.
They were three world-class players, each of them won European Player of the Year. 64, it was Dennis Law, 66, Bobby Charlton, 68, George Best.
The side were going from strength to strength and went on to win the championship in 1965. The success owed much to Busby's particular management style.
When Matt became very successful, there was the idea some people had that he put the frighteners on the players, because the players, if you spoke to them, gave you the clear impression that they were very worried if Matt decided that he didn't approve of what they were up to, either on the field or off the field. But that had nothing to do with bullying or bellowing. Matt could do more by raising an eyebrow than most people could do with a lot of decibels.
He expected to go every morning in a collar and tie. And the funny thing is, he wouldn't allow you to wear anything blue because of Manchester City.
You always knew when you told him, when he told you something, that was it. You knew exactly where you stood with him. There was no change in minds or anything like that. Absolutely spot on he was.
When you were on the field, you were playing not only for Manchester United, you were playing for Sir Matt Busby.
He had that aura about him, and it's hard for people today to realise. In my day, or our day, you had the priest, the minister, the policeman, the lawyer, and when you met them in the morning, because that aura about them, good morning, sir, the boss had that aura about him.
I remember as a boy of 15, 16, he would send for me to take them to his office, and I would stand outside his door, and I didn't need to knock, truly, because my knees were doing the knocking. For no reason other than this was Mr. Busby, and I was just so much in awe of him.
Busby also had his own particular way of dealing with players who were not performing.
He would come and put his arm around you. It was the worst experience you ever had in your life, because you'd seen him do it with many other players, but the minute he'd done that, he knew you weren't playing on a Saturday.
If you put his arm around your shoulder, we called it the dreaded arm. And, of course, that was it.
I dropped for some reason, I forget what it was, but he said to me, how do you think you're playing? And I said, well, I think I'm all right, maybe being a little bit unlucky in one form or another, one way or another, but nevertheless, I'm okay. You know, I think I'm doing not too bad. Anyway, he said, well, I'm just going to give you a little rest.
I don't think too many people in this country have come across a player who had more street hardness than my old friend from the Gorbals, Paddy Cairn, when he came down to Man United. But I can testify that Paddy was like a jelly if Matt disapproved of him.
He lost his temper with me, because I wasn't the best timekeeper. I was absolutely hopeless.
Paddy was late, obviously just getting into the usual fankle in his room, scrambling about, packing and so on. Hadn't been up to any mischief, but came onto the bus in a great whirl of dishevelment, and you know, he knew right away that there was something coming, and Matt said, you must be a very important man. He said, you've kept the directors of Manchester United waiting, you've kept me waiting, you've kept the press waiting. He said, it must be wonderful to be as important as you are. And Paddy sat down next to me, and I'll tell you, he felt like a pretty important fugitive.
From the public point of view, he was a very calm figure. But if you weren't particularly doing your job, or you know, performing to what you should be performing, there was a volley in the dressing room. But then it stayed there; it didn't come onto the field.
He got what he wanted by his manner and his style. But he could be fearsome with the players. And, you know, the old saying about the iron fist in the velvet glove was true to him, because he would not have been as successful as he was if he couldn't deal with players. He dealt with the Football Association, he dealt with the Football League, and he was a tiger, he really was.
Matt Busby also realised that there was more to a successful football club than just the players.
Even to the staff, the girls who worked in the laundry and everything, he knew them all. And anybody could approach him. He had time for everybody.
He made my mother, who was a laundry lady, who washed the kit and scrubbed the shorts, he made her feel special. He made me as a boy, 15, 16, he made you feel special. He made you want to do things. He didn't have to shout, raise his voice or whatever else. He didn't use his authority. But he had this quiet authority, which was just amazing.
Busby had a special love for United's band of supporters, as one particular fan whose father died while attending a game will testify.
So Matt came to my father's funeral, and he was buried at St. Clair's in Blakely, and he stood, he chatted to people, he wished the family all the best, and went on his quiet way. And that was an amazing experience, really, for all of us. We didn't expect it, no one looked for it, but he was prepared to reach out to one of his supporters in a way that don't think many people would do.
Busby's own family background contributed to his success at United, with his wife Jean, who he had married shortly after joining Manchester City in 1928, held in great esteem by those associated with the club.
Sheer sincerity itself.
She wanted to make sure that everybody was cared for, that everybody was happy. I think really she just wanted everybody to be as happy as she and Matt were. It was as simple as that.
When I was a young teenager, my mother became ill and with cancer, with cervical cancer, and she was dying. And Uncle Matt and Auntie Jean took me in occasionally for a week at a time, because my house at that time was a dark place to be, not physically but very mentally, because my mother obviously was dying and my father was extremely sad about it, and I was the only child. And Uncle Matt used to just have me at his home with Auntie Jean, and they just took care of me.
I don't think it would be possible to exaggerate how much Lady Jean, as she became, meant to Sir Matt as he became. I think when they were Jean and Matt, the mutual nourishment was immense, and I think that continued right through Matt's life.
It became a family club. I mean, his daughter and his son Sandy used to come down, and Sandy was one of the boys used to come out with us. And of course, Mrs. Busby, everybody loved her.
When we used to go abroad, maybe in those days, I'm not talking about abroad for a European match, go on tour and you'd be away for 6 weeks or all, something like that. Jean Busby, Matt's wife, would take everybody out at least once a week, come out and we'll have a nice night out and all this sort of thing. The Busby family were terrific.
As a result of their championship success in the season of 65-66, United had qualified for Europe for the first time since 1958. After an emotional return, they beat Benfica in the quarter-final, but failed to beat Partizan Belgrade in the semis. The conclusion of the 66-67 season saw them title winners again and saw them qualify for Europe for the 67-68 season. Wins against Hibernians, Sarajevo and Górnik Zabrze saw them reach the semi-finals, and after a 1-0 victory at home to Real Madrid, the return fixture saw them trailing 3-1 at half-time.
We came into the dressing room at half-time and it was silent.
Just before the whistle is going to go for us to come out, the boss walked in, and as we got up to go, and the whistle went in, and as we got up to go, he just said, sit down. You know? He said, that's not the Manchester United way. Defending. Go out and attack. Go out and enjoy it. Amazing. You know what I mean? He took all the pressure off us.
We started chasing the ball. We started wanting the ball. We started challenging for the ball more than we had done in the first half. David Sadler got a half shot. That's all I could describe it as, a half shot. He just sort of threw his leg at the ball and it went inside the post.
5 minutes after David Sadler scores, I start to move out from the back over the halfway line. And Bill Foulkes, that's another half, as hard as nails, really as hard as nails. He just turns to me and says, don't you dare move. He said, we're keeping it tight. You know, he was happy with the 3-3. I said, I didn't argue with Bill, no problem, Bill, no problem. 5 minutes later, Best George went to the byline, pulled the ball back, and who's on the end of it? Bill Foulkes. He's told me not to move.
And he gave him this gorgeous press, you know, just off the ground. The right height and right speed.
And we went into the dressing room, and I've never seen Mad Busby and Jimmy Murphy so happy. Never seen them so happy. They were just so pleased.
The victory saw them through to the final against Portuguese side Benfica, to be played on English soil.
The whole match seemed to be, on the build-up, seemed to be very emotional with regard to Man United.
Never known such tension in Wembley Stadium before. This is a tremendous emotional occasion. United have got Benfica on the run now. Sadler, Charlton, a goal! He scored! Charlton has scored! Grata, Sergosto. Torres,
He ran on the field, and suddenly every player, all of the players grabbed hold of him.
When Matt led the way, we all applauded him and went for him because we knew how much it meant for him especially. Not just for Manchester United, for him.
It was amazing. It was. That was another situation where the players felt it was for him. You know, they'd won the European Cup. Not for Manchester United, they'd won it for Matt Busby.
I think it was a big sense of the memory of the players that had died at Munich as well, and we all knew that Matt wanted to win the European Cup. He'd be the instigator of English sides going into Europe. And it was great to see him at the end. We, to a certain degree, we wanted him to go up and get the trophy, but he didn't want to do it. I just think he was emotionally probably overcome by at last his dream was realised.
It must have meant so much more to, I mean, for example, people like Bobby who played and Bill Foulkes. You know, they got out of the plane. And Matt, you know, I mean Matt, that the significance of winning Europe and the, if you like, the justification of all those years and what had gone on, it must have been immense.
I never quite forget getting back to the hotel. It's a wonderful world. Louis Armstrong, that was number one in the hit parade. He never shut up all night. Every time you saw him, he was singing that song. But it must have been fantastic for him to think of all those great players he'd lost, what, 10 years previous, and now within a period of 10 years to win the European Cup. Fantastic feat.
That night at Wembley was a crowning glory for us all. For the players that had gone in the crash, for Bobby Charlton and Bill Foulkes, who were members of that team, who fortunately survived, even the players, the directors, Laird was the chairman, and directors, and everybody concerned. It was a night of achievement. This is what was the object of the exercise from the start. And with the tragedy, there was
just... His victory over Benfica had been the crowning moment of Busby's career, and he was knighted after the club's European Cup triumph.
Matt had an overview of his life, you know, and he knew just what a suitable punctuation mark winning the European Cup was. And it would seem to him, I think, that this was an appropriate time to step aside.
He knew he couldn't go on forever. He wanted to be around to try and foster whoever would come through. And so really, he knew that he would stay on with the club, but he needed to hand it over to somebody else.
The period following, you know, Matt's retirement, well, no, you can't get away from it. They were difficult times. They were always going to be difficult times. Nobody was in any doubt of that.
He offered the job to Dave Sexton when he first finished. Mum and Dad had gone on a holiday, and Dave Sexton had phoned me at home, and he said, would you pass a message on to your father that I am very happy at Chelsea?
Busby turned to the club and saw a potential successor in 31-year-old ex-player Wilf McGuinness.
I had no idea that he was going to choose me as the next team manager, or the, you know. So when I did find out, it was only the day before, really, when he said to me, tomorrow I want you to come in smart with a suit and tie.
But McGuinness's tenure was to last just over 18 months, and he left the club in December 1970, leaving Matt back in control temporarily. The club's search for a successor saw Frank O'Farrell, Tommy Docherty, Dave Sexton and Ron Atkinson all take the reins, but none of them could replace the man they called the boss.
There had been a few mistakes made, maybe appointing people that actually couldn't possibly fill his shoes. And but when Alex Ferguson came, he was very, very self-satisfied and quite pleased with himself.
He seemed quite a satisfied man. You know, he was quiet and seemed to just probably reflect on a great life he'd had and a great career. I used to always nip into his office when he was in the building, because you could smell his pipe, you know. When you come in that door, you could smell his pipe, and he was in.
Matt didn't take very long to realise that the club was in the kind of hands that he had felt all along it should be.
It wouldn't be long before the new boss would get the benefit of Sir Matt's experience.
I came in and he says, "How's things, son?" I said, "Oh, this is the press, I kill me." And he says, "Why read it?" And he said, "I never read it," which was the best advice he could ever get.
Alex, I think he got a lot of help by knowing that Matt Busby was there and that Matt Busby was satisfied with him.
And Alex Ferguson's plans for the club's future had a familiar Busby-like ring to them.
I just felt that if I was going to make this club a great club again, I had to work with the foundations. What I had in the first team I had, there's nothing I could do about it. But what I could do, and what I did do, was do something about the youth situation.
Alex Ferguson's United, including many players who had been brought through from the youth teams, finally won the Premiership title in 1993.
I remember it very well when United won the title, the first time in 26 years. And Rick Parry was the chief executive of the Football Association or something at that time, became the chief executive of Liverpool Football Club. He presented the trophy, and if you look back at all the pictures taken, much right behind Steve Bruce and Brian Robson when they went up to receive the trophy. And I'm thinking to myself, why in God's earth did they not get Matt to present the trophy?
Alongside his knighthood, Busby was already a CBE and was awarded a papal knighthood in 1972 as recognition for his charity work. The club honoured him with his own testimonial against a Republic of Ireland 11 in 1991.
I thought I'd like to give every supporter a card as he went into the ground. And I said to Matt, well, maybe you could say something on the back of this card. I'll put my picture on one side. And so he wrote this, which I've always kept. He just took a pen and he wrote this down. And it was really fascinating. "I wish to thank all concerned who helped organise this special occasion. And to all you wonderful fans, people both young and old, who have supported the club and myself." Notice the club comes before him. "So, throughout the years, from the bottom of my heart, many thanks to you and God bless you all, Matt Busby."
It was actually one of our neighbours who came knocking on the door and said, "Have you heard?" He'd just heard on the radio that Matt had died. Within an hour, I had a call from the airline that I worked for saying, "We've got two tickets here. I'm sure you want to fly home for Matt's funeral." And yes, we flew back to share the sadness of Manchester.
And the turnout at the church was incredible. It was absolutely incredible. It wasn't a very nice day either. And I remember that they had to come round and brought the coffin round Old Trafford before taking it out to Southern Cemetery to bury it. It was just, the crowd was immense. But then when you have thousands of people turning up at your funeral, you must have done something decent in your life.
The crowds, they were lining the streets when he went past the football ground, you know. The church was absolutely heaving.
I was privileged to do the eulogy at his funeral, which was one of the privileges of my life. And I remember I made a prayer card for that, and wrote a prayer on the back. And just as we'd given something to everyone who went in to play in the testimonial, we gave people that prayer card when they went into the church for the funeral.
Here was somebody who had lived a very fulfilling life in all areas, but especially in relation to his life's work at Manchester United.
There was flags from everywhere. Strips from clubs that you wouldn't think. I mean, Liverpool and United, the fans don't like each other. That doesn't make you say the clubs don't like each other. We played Everton here after Matt had died, and the minute silence was fantastic. Great credit to the Everton fans for that. You'd hope it would have been everybody else would have been the same, but Everton were fantastic.
Alex Ferguson's United were a team Busby could be proud of, but they owed much to what Busby himself had given them.
He created the foundation of all. He gave the vision. He gave the way Manchester United should be.
So when managers like myself come to follow that, what you do is you don't try to copy, you try to maintain.
My dad's achievements over his era was second to none. What he achieved, what he went through. Now, the great man is Sir Alex Ferguson. What he has achieved, it won't be achieved again, no way.
I think United have gone on with that tradition, really, of playing attacking open football, adventurous football. And Sir Alex is a perfect step on.
He's left a legacy for young players, because he was never afraid to put young players into the team.
Even today, the up-and-coming young players at United are made aware of the club's history.
Right from the start, the under-8s and 9s coaches will be given little bits of information about the history of Manchester United, the great players. And obviously central to that is Sir Matt Busby and the story of the Busby Babes.
Paul McGuinness has been great, showing us lots of DVDs about it, and here I am now, just 18, and I'm trying my best to break to the first team.
Here you are, 14, 15, 16, going to tournaments, and Sir Matt Busby was there on the plane with you, and he was there watching games, and you'd see him around the hotel, so instantly you knew the history of the club, because such a great manager was coming to tournaments like this.
The way in which we have young players, Kiko Makeda coming in 2-3 each, 18 years of age, Danny Welbeck playing at Wembley, Rafael da Silva, all these players that are coming through now, it's a continuation of what Sir Matt Busby brought to this club.
The United fans still sing Matt Busby songs today. You hear at Stretford and what a great crowd they are, and it's just unbelievable.
Walk down Sir Matt Busby Way now, and like you say, when I was growing up, you're singing songs about Sir Matt Busby every single match.
I've got 60,000-70,000 people here every week who will sing verses from the United Calypso. United Calypso, written in 1957, and probably sung every week ever since, which extols the virtues of the Busby Babes.
Sir Matt Busby's association with Manchester United spanned 49 years and saw the club go from near dereliction to be the most popular football club in the world. At Manchester United, his life and his legacy will never be forgotten.
A lot of what we see today, the way in which the club plays football, the way in which the club is thought of around the world, he's a massive part of that.
Busby gave United that glamour, really. He gave us that glamour that we were more than just an ordinary football club. We were extraordinary.
I mean, when you look around this place, it's all down to him. He started it all. He's got a lot to answer for. I laugh when I think about it, because we all have success in Europe, but it's costing the other man a fortune now. So you're to blame, Matt.
If he came back now and saw Manchester United, the ground, he still is. He's the proudest man in heaven, isn't he? You know?
He was a great man. Not just a manager, he was a great man. Not just people with the football team, people surrounding, He was just one of those people, kind of people. He was a great man.